Dear YouTube, as you know, under copyright law, I am allowed to use portions of copyrighted material, in this case, copyrighted material belonging to the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society of Pennsylvania, so long as this is used for the purpose of criticism and parody. Please remember this when Watchtower comes complaining because I've embarrassed them by using their propaganda in a way they disapprove of. Thank you. Hello there. Well, for this rebuttal video, I've decided to film from my desk for no other reason than because it's more comfortable and also it's just nice to mix things up from time to time. In this video, I'll be taking a look at the April 2016 JW Broadcasting episode featuring governing body helper William Malenfant. So without further ado, let's roll the first clip.
The theme of this program is Look Back to Learn. Look ahead to live.
Well, that's not at all threatening. An interesting feature of this rebuttal is how much William Malenfant litters his comments with supposition. So in other words, he will say things like, this must have happened, or this may have happened, as you'll see in the following clip.
Looking back to our first human parents, we see clearly the importance of obeying Jehovah. For hundreds of years, Adam and Eve must have looked back to the life they had in the Garden of Eden before they sinned, but they felt no joy in doing so. As they grew older and more decrepit, they must have been filled with sadness and bitterness, and there may have been many exchanges of unkind words.
Now, I personally don't believe that Adam and Eve existed. The more we learn about archaeology, the more we realize that the human race is actually hundreds of thousands of years old rather than only 6,000 years old. But even if Adam and Eve were historical characters, William Malenfant simply has no way of knowing whether their old age was filled with sadness and bitterness or whether they were constantly at each other's throats. Such sweeping assumptions are total stabs in the dark and not the sort of thing you'd expect to find coming out of an organisation that is truly interested in careful scholarly study of the Bible.
Noah, who was born about 126 years after Adam died, would have known of Adam's disobedience and its consequences. Noah looked back and benefited from that knowledge. He obeyed Jehovah and fixed his eyes on the unseen future, the foretold earthwide flood. Also, he kept busy constructing an ark and preaching to the people of his day. It is only reasonable to believe that Noah's three sons cooperated fully with him in building the ark.
Like so many biblical creationists, including Jehovah's Witnesses, William Malenfant seems to be under the impression that Noah's flood was an actual historical event. A quick glimpse of our useful timeline on page 294 of the book All Scripture is Inspired of God and Beneficial reveals that Jehovah's Witnesses believe that the flood happened in 2370 BCE. This means that if you're a Jehovah's Witness, you have to believe that Noah's flood actually happened 4,385 years ago. There are a number of problems with that, though, not least of which is the fact that we now have at least one item of clothing that has been dated older than that.
An ancient Egyptian dress that was discovered in the early 1990s was recently confirmed as the world's oldest known woven garment. Radiocarbon dating has determined the finely tailored linen dress found in an Egyptian tomb to be between 5,100 and 5,500 years old. In addition to being notable for its longevity, the clothing is distinctive due to the great attention to detail employed during its making. The fabric features a pale stripe, and the garment has a number of areas embellished with intricate pleating.
This, of course, means that if, like William Malenfant, you insist on believing that Noah's flood actually happened, apart from the fact that you have to believe that Noah somehow managed to squeeze two of every kind of 6.5 million land-dwelling species into a wooden box, apart from the fact that there literally are not enough water molecules on the planet to inundate the land surface, apart from all of that, you also have to accept that the Egyptian civilization was up and running for at least hundreds of years before the flood happened, and this particular item of clothing managed to survive the floodwaters intact.
Genesis 19, 12, and 13 tell us not only that Sodom would be destroyed, but also that Lot and his people in the city should flee immediately. Then verse 17 says that as soon as the angels had brought Lot and his family to the outskirts of Sodom, they were told, "Escape for your life. Do not look behind you, and do not stand still in any part of the district. Escape to the mountainous region so that you may not be swept away." Lot's wife disobediently began to look back, and she became a pillar of salt.
Ah, yes, a woman is turned into a pillar of salt simply for looking in the wrong direction. Well, that sounds perfectly reasonable.
Now a further test of loyalty faced Lot and his daughters. Was Lot's attachment to his deceased wife, or the girls' feelings for their dead mother, stronger than their love for Jehovah, who had brought about this calamity? Would they continue to obey God, even though someone very close to them proved disloyal to him? With full trust in Jehovah, they did not look back. Is there not a lesson in this account for us?
Yes, the charming story of Lot and his daughters. Whatever became of that family? Well, if we read on in Genesis 19, verse 30, it says, "Later, Lot went up from Zoar with his two daughters and began living in the mountainous region, because he was afraid to live in Zoar. So he began living in a cave with his two daughters. And the firstborn said to the younger, 'Our father is old, and there is not a man in the land to have relations with us according to the custom of the whole earth. Come, let us give our father wine to drink, and let us lie down with him and preserve offspring from our father.'" And then later in verse 36, "So both daughters of Lot became pregnant by their father. The firstborn gave birth to a son and named him Moab. He is the father of the Moabites of today. The younger also gave birth to a son, and she named him Ben-Ammi. He is the father of the Ammonites of today." I think these might have been the two daughters who Lot offered to the men of Sodom for them to gang rape, so that the angels who were visiting wouldn't be disturbed. All in all, a charming story that gives us so many moral lessons.
And what about her? What can we learn by examining his life? No, this is not the Ben-Hur from the movie. This Hur lived during the time period of Moses and Joshua. Like many of Jehovah's people, he played a supporting role in doing God's will. We don't know much about him, but what we do know shows that he was available and willing to give support to Moses.
And when we're talking about her giving Moses support, we mean it in a very literal way.
Exodus 17, 8 through 13 reads as follows. "Then the Amalekites came and fought against Israel in Rephidim. At this, Moses said to Joshua, 'Choose men for us and go out to fight against the Amalekites. Tomorrow, I will stand on top of the hill with the rod of the true God in my hand.' Then Joshua did just as Moses told him, and he fought against the Amalekites. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. As long as Moses kept his hands lifted up, the Israelites prevailed. But as soon as he would let down his hands, the Amalekites prevailed. When the hands of Moses were heavy, they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Then Aaron and Hur, one on each side, supported his hands, so that his hands remained steady until the sun set. Thus Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the sword."
There's two things I want to talk about with this verse, and perhaps I'll start with the most obvious issue that I have. And this is this idea that Jehovah would only support the Israelites and divinely bless their victory if Moses's arms were in an upright position. That apparently was crucial in whether the Israelites were successful against the Amalekites. And I can only say that that is an extremely petty demand to make. Either the Amalekites need to be annihilated or they don't. Why does it make a difference what configuration Moses' limbs are in? Rather than impressing me that this guy named Hur was able to support Moses by keeping his arms aloft, what this verse actually does is give me the strong impression that Jehovah may have had OCD. Then we have this whole question of waging war against the Amalekites, a war that amounted to genocide and an attempt to exterminate them from the earth. And if you look at the Insight volumes on Amalek, so there's Insight from the Scriptures, Volume 1. The Amalekites are listed under Amalek on pages 86 and 87. It's interesting to note that although there was this constant fighting between the Israelites and the Amalekites, it wasn't until Hezekiah that the Amalekites were finally exterminated. And it actually uses the word exterminated in here. So it says on pages 86 and 87, during the reign of Hezekiah, some of the tribe of Simeon annihilated the remnant of the Amalekites. And it quotes 1 Chronicles 4, verses 42 and 43. It says, there is no further direct mention of the Amalekites in biblical or secular history. Actually, there never was any mention of the Amalekites in secular history. Try looking on Wikipedia or wherever you need to look. There is no mention of the Amalekites apart from in the Bible. And then further on it says, thus the Amalekites, along with others mentioned by name, were exterminated, in order that people may know that you, whose name is Jehovah, you alone are the Most High over all the earth. And I would again argue that if Jehovah insists that an entire nation of people be exterminated as a way of impressing upon people how great he is, that for me is the hallmark of a maniac. You don't win brownie points and earn respect by slaughtering entire nations of people. Now, if there is one verse that epitomizes the cruelty and barbarity of the attitude of the God of the Bible towards this people called the Amalekites, who were arguably fictitious, but if there's one verse that really sums up the depravity, it's arguably in Numbers 31. And I'll begin reading in verse 13, but I'm going to read right through to verse 18. It says, then Moses and Eleazar the priest and all the chieftains of the assembly went out to meet them outside the camp. But Moses grew indignant at the appointed men of the combat forces, the chiefs of the thousands and the chiefs of the hundreds who were coming in from the military expedition. Moses said to them, have you preserved all the females alive? Look, they are the ones who by Balaam's word induced the Israelites to commit unfaithfulness toward Jehovah over the affair of Peor, so that the scourge came upon the assembly of Jehovah. Now you should kill every male among the children, and kill every woman who has had sexual relations with a man. So Moses goes out to the military officers that are returning from campaigning against the Amalekites and chastises them for not being sufficiently genocidal in massacring all of the women. But then it says in verse 18, Moses' words, but you may keep alive all the young girls who have not had sexual relations with a man. Full stop. Next verse. Now, the reason why I'm emphasising this verse is because it's different in the New World Translation to in almost every other translation. And I believe the reason why it's different is because Watchtower is deliberately trying to tone down the barbarity of Moses and of, you know, by extension, Jehovah. I happen to have a parallel Bible, which one of my viewers kindly sent to me at some expense. So this is the complete parallel Bible, And what it does is it has these four translations of the Bible: the New Revised Standard Version, the Revised English Bible, the New American Bible, and the New Jerusalem Bible. It has them side by side so you can quickly check what the same verse says. And if I look up Numbers 31:18, it says in the New Revised Standard Version, "But all the young girls who have not known a man by sleeping with him, keep alive for yourselves." Keep them alive for yourselves. In the Revised English Bible, the verse says, "But you may spare for yourselves every woman among them who has not had intercourse." So again, the impression is given, spare them for yourselves. The New American Bible, in verse 18, "But you may spare and keep for yourselves all girls who had no intercourse with a man." And finally, the New Jerusalem Bible, verse 18, "But spare the lives of the young girls who have never slept with a man and keep them for yourselves." I'll read you again the way the same verse is rendered in the toned down New World Translation. "But you may keep alive all the young girls who have not had sexual relations with a man," implying, well, just let them live. Let them live, you know. That's not how the same verse is rendered in all the other Bibles. And you might be thinking, well, what's the point of all this? Well, implicit in that verse is the idea that the virgins were to be kept for the private use, and I mean sexual use, of the victorious soldiers. And I'm not the only one who has read this meaning into it, as you will see in the following clip, in which Christopher Hitchens, the late Christopher Hitchens, debates with the Reverend Al Sharpton.
You say these texts are misused. I say that they are not. The Old Testament says, or does not say, that Abraham was doing a noble thing by offering to sacrifice a son to prove himself loyal to God, or to the voices he was hearing in his head. It says there was a noble thing for him to do. He was rewarded for it by a great posterity and a great long life. Offering to murder his son because of hearing voices in his head. This is not moral teaching to me. Is it not the case that the Old Testament says that the Amalekites must all be destroyed down to the last child, every one among them? Leave not one. Yes, it does say that. The Bishop of Llandaff, in an argument with Thomas Paine, once said, well, when it says keep the women, as Paine had pointed out, he said, I'm sure God didn't mean just to keep them for immoral purposes. But what does the Bishop of Llandaff know about that? He says, kill all the men, kill all the children, and keep the virgins. I think I know what they had in mind. I don't think it's moral teaching.
Of course, not everyone will agree with Hitchens' conclusions when it comes to the nature of the God of the Bible. But my point in showing you that verse and showing you that clip is to just simply demonstrate that you really need to be very selective when it comes to showing verses that instill upon people a respect for God or a respect for certain Bible characters. You basically need to cherry pick, and you need to hope that people won't do digging to find out what the real story is behind the verses you're showing them.
And now consider a man who was a gross wrongdoer, guilty of the most heinous crimes and violations of God's laws. He was King Manasseh. Not only does the Bible account of his repentance amaze us, but even more outstanding is the fact that Jehovah accepted his repentance and showed him mercy. How kind of Jehovah to allow this account to be in his word. We look back to Manasseh, who stands as an example of the great mercy that Jehovah extends to all who genuinely repent of their wrongdoings and make straight paths for their feet. Manasseh's repentance must have been genuine, for no one can deceive Jehovah.
So now we're given this story of Manasseh, and I decided to do some digging again in the Insight books to find out exactly what it was that Manasseh did that he was forgiven for. And on page 307, it tells us. So it says, he, that's Manasseh, did what was bad in Jehovah's eyes. rebuilding the high places his father had destroyed, setting up altars to Baal, worshipping all the army of the heavens, and building false religious altars in two temple courtyards. He made his sons pass through the fire, practiced magic, employed divination, and promoted spiritistic practices. Manasseh also put the graven image of the sacred pole he had made into the house of Jehovah. He seduced Judah and Jerusalem to do worse than the nations that Jehovah had annihilated from before the sons of Israel. Though Jehovah sent prophets, these were not heeded. Manasseh was also guilty of shedding innocent blood in great quantity, which, according to the literature of the Jewish rabbis, included that of Isaiah, who they say was sawed apart at Manasseh's command. And it cites Hebrews 11, verse 37, which I'll briefly read to you. Hebrews 11, 37. They, this is the prophets, were stoned, they were tried, they were sawn in two. They were slaughtered by the sword. So this guy Manasseh, you know, we're given the impression that he did one or two bad things, but it's all okay because he repented, he apologized, and, you know, it was all good. But I just find it remarkable that here we have somebody who sacrificed his children by burning them, who killed people, including the prophet Isaiah, who, according to Jewish tradition, was, you know, sawn in two by this man. Why was mercy extended to King Manasseh, but not to Lot's wife? If God has the ability to turn someone into a pillar of salt, why did he use that power to punish Lot's wife the moment she turned back to look at her home city being destroyed? Why did he not use that power to turn King Manasseh into a pillar of salt before he sacrificed his children, or before he slaughtered all those people, or sawed the prophet Isaiah in two?
How much we appreciate the brochure, Return to Jehovah. It constitutes a loving invitation to take the necessary steps to draw close to Jehovah and then remain in his love.
Ah, yes, the Return to Jehovah brochure. One of these days, I'm going to get around to doing a video just about this brochure, which was produced, as we know, to bring back some of those who have got bored of being lied to by Watchtower and just gone ahead and done their own thing. But just to explain briefly, the problem with this brochure is it doesn't assume that there is a problem that the individual has with the organization. In other words, it assumes that the organization itself is flawless and there is no possible justifiable reason why someone would stop being a Jehovah's Witness or would stop going to meetings. It assumes that the fault is with the person who leaves. And just to briefly show you how this is so, lesson one is the lost one I will search for. So if you stop going to witness meetings, you're lost. You're a sheep that's wandered astray. Lesson two, anxiety. So if you stop going to meetings, it's because you've allowed life to get the better of you and you're too stressed and you should calm down. Lesson three, hurt feelings. If you stop going to the meetings, it's because you're bearing a grudge against someone. It's a personal thing between you and an individual. Yes, I'm sure there are witnesses who stop going to meetings for that reason, but in my own case, I stopped going to meetings because I just didn't like being lied to anymore. And lesson four, guilt. Cleanse me from my sin. And I think this is, why Watchtower thinks most witnesses leave is because they've done something that could get them disfellowships and they don't want to face judicial action. So again, it's all the onus is all on the person who has stopped attending meetings. Watchtower is completely off the hook. In the governing body's minds, Watchtower can do no wrong. So what a dreadful little brochure, and what a perfect example of Watchtower's head-in-the-sand approach to dealing with its own problems.
And Jesus has also proved to be faithful to his promise to be with his disciples to the end of the system of things. Do we not see evidence of that today?
So yes, apparently there's loads of evidence that Jesus is backing Jehovah's Witnesses today. William Malenfant just isn't in the mood to show it to us now.
The Apostle John was another man of great faith and endurance. At about 99 years of age, the Apostle John looked back some 65 years and was able, with the help of Holy Spirit, to remember so much about Jesus' life and works that he could write the Gospel of John.
Interestingly, John remembered things quite differently to the writers of the other Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, which scholars refer to as the Synoptic Gospels. And I'm going to give you a quick rundown of some of the main differences between the Gospel of John and the Synoptic Gospels. In John, there is no mention of Jesus being born in Bethlehem. John also omits the Sermon on the Mount and Christ's conversation with his disciples on the Mount of Olives. You know, the one where he mentions the faithful and discreet slave. John does mention the resurrection of Lazarus, whereas the Synoptic Gospels don't. You would think that the writers of Matthew, Mark, and Luke would consider it a sufficiently big deal that Jesus successfully brought someone back from the dead. In the Synoptic Gospels, the Lord's evening meal happens on Passover Eve. In John, it happens the night before Passover Eve. John has Jesus overturning the tables of the money changers at the beginning of his ministry, whereas the Synoptic Gospels have Jesus doing this shortly before his death. In the Synoptic Gospels, Christ's ministry happens roughly over the course of 1 year. In John, it happens over the course of 3 years. And in John, only Mary Magdalene visits Jesus' tomb and discovers the stone has been removed, whereas in the Synoptic Gospels, at least two or more women make this discovery.
Later, as a young man of 19 years, I also was arrested in the former GDR for proclaiming the Word of God. I was sentenced to 12 years in prison, but I had only to serve 6 years. What I learned is that Jehovah really helps at the right time. The time of interrogation was difficult. I was put in a solitary confinement cell in a cellar with only very little light. I did not have any strength anymore. In the cell there was not much, only a plank bed for sleeping and on the wall a board with house rules that I didn't take notice of. I looked at it and I turned it around. And what did I read on the back? The lyrics of a song of our songbook. It said, "Fear them not, O my beloved, though men's boasting threats may fly." Immediately I regained my strength.
Watching this part of the broadcast actually made me go to my collection and fish out this, which is the Kingdom Service Songbook. It's actually one of the early songbooks and it was circulated in 1944. And it's the same one that's featured in this little segment here. And I just found it interesting because when you look up Song 12, it's called Fear Them Not. And it's an earlier version of a song that, you know, I grew up with. But it's interesting to see what the early lyrics sounded like. So the beginning, I'll just briefly try and sing it for you. Ever onward, O my people, let the kingdom tidings go. Tremble not before your foe, let all men of goodwill know. And then in the chorus, it goes, fear them not, O my beloved, though their boasting threats may fly. I will keep my faithful servant as the apple of mine eye. So that was how it originally went. It ended with, as the apple of mine eye. And I noticed in that segment, you couldn't just make out the word Apfel in the German translation. But on a more serious note, it's sad to see this recurring theme in these JW broadcasting episodes where martyrdom is encouraged, where stories of persecution are wheeled out with the aim of impressing upon Jehovah's Witnesses that no sacrifice is too great when it comes to appeasing the organization. If you're suffering in some way, if you're being persecuted in some way, then you should be grateful because that's what Jehovah wants from you.
I used to wonder how the good news was going to reach deaf people in places like Russia, China, and India. But one by one, Jehovah has removed obstacles. And so, for example, today, there are more than 3,500 Jehovah's Witnesses who use Russian Sign Language. And worldwide, there are more than 24,000 deaf Jehovah's Witnesses. We see all of this as a fulfillment of Bible prophecy and as an evidence of Jehovah's blessing.
Yes, 24,000 deaf Jehovah's Witnesses are a fulfillment of Bible prophecy and evidence of Jehovah's blessing.
Our team found the encouraging example of Brother Jose Luis Ayala, who lives in Mexico City. He was born deaf and then became completely blind by the age of 29. When he found the truth and wanted to study the Bible, our brothers lovingly made the effort to help him overcome these obstacles.
I was devastated. Being completely deaf and now blind was depressing. Life became difficult. I had to use a cane. I couldn't get around like I used to. I became afraid of walking on my own. I was very sad. Then I met the witnesses, and they treated me well. Their conduct was different from the people at my old job, who often mistreated me. As I learned more and more about the Bible, my life changed.
Notice how we see the same trick that was used in last month's JW Broadcasting episode, where we start off with black and white footage denoting how desperate this man's plight is, but then when he meets the witnesses, everything springs into colour, denoting how wonderful his life has suddenly become. This is a classic propaganda technique, but we're not done yet because watch how it is going to roll out another tear-jerking method that was used in last month's broadcast.
When I feel that 30 minutes have passed, I finish, and instead of clapping, everybody applauds with their feet so I can feel it. They've told me that some in the audience begin to cry. It's not easy for me to deliver a talk, but when I realize this may encourage others, the effort is worth it.
We all struggle with certain experiences and difficulties in life. However, when you talk with Jose Luis, and see the things he does, and how he loves Jehovah, how he serves him with a complete heart. His living example shows us there is no obstacle too great.
Apparently, it's now impossible to have a JW Broadcasting episode that doesn't feature people welling up with tears and crying on camera to try and wrench at the heartstrings of the audience. Because as we all know, if you can drill through to people's emotions, then you can bypass their need for logic, reason, and evidence. And most outrageous of all, in two consecutive JW Broadcasting episodes, both the April and the March 2016 episodes, we have this phenomenon where the interpreter who is interpreting from another language into English is actually feigning a teary voice in order to try and again pull on the heartstrings of the audience. It's so contrived, it's so artificial, and yet I'm sure loads of witnesses will fall for this.
I patiently wait for the future that I've learned about. I strive to be worthy to see with my own eyes what we hope for so much. Even if I die, I know Jehovah can resurrect me. In the future, when I can see again, I can imagine the tears when I see and hear all the brothers and sisters who have been my friends, and to be able to greet them in person. How nice it will be to give them a hug. It will make me so happy and thankful for the blessing of Jehovah. This is my hope.
If there's one thing that's more sad than a man who has been deaf since birth and is now deprived of his sight, it is the thought of a cult that is exploiting him and perpetually dangling this carrot in front of him of belief that if he will only stick close to their organisation, he can have all of these maladies, all of these disabilities removed. That is an extremely cynical way to exploit somebody and derive what you need from them. And as if that isn't bad enough, this man's credulity and this man's false hopes are being cynically used as a tool for enticing yet more people to embrace unquestioned loyalty to the governing body. We've seen this a lot in recent episodes where people with disabilities are used in this way, and I have a feeling we're going to see a lot more of it in future episodes.
In this dramatization, a Christian family is devastated by natural disaster, but finds a way to once again rejoice in the hope.
What is there to look forward to? I've been thinking about this for a while now. Recently, a huge typhoon hit our area and inflicted severe damage. Now, three generations of our family are temporarily living together in a small apartment.
Ah yes, another family devastated by a deadly typhoon. Would this be the same typhoon, Typhoon Maysak, that was mentioned in the January 2016 broadcast? The same typhoon that killed four people, injured 10, caused $8.5 million worth of damage to property, but was used by Jehovah, apparently, to deliver sand to build a kingdom hall.
Somehow, our family is keeping up our spiritual routine. But to be honest, our hearts aren't really in it. We lost some close friends, our house, and a car. From that day on, it's like we can't think or feel anything. We are just going through the motions.
Frankly, I think most Jehovah's Witnesses are going through the motions, regardless of whether they are victims of some kind of disaster. Because the simple truth is that so much of being a Jehovah's Witness isn't natural. It's not natural to routinely go and badger people to embrace your religious beliefs on their doorsteps. It's not natural to have to attend a building one or two times a week to be reminded of what you believe. But these are all part of the Jehovah's Witness routine that are required in order to reinforce the delusion, in order to reinforce the indoctrination. If you're a scientist, or if you are someone who respects logic and reason and evidence, you don't need to routinely be reminded of that. You don't need to go to weekly indoctrination sessions to embrace the universe the way it is. You can just pick up a book at your leisure and expand your mind in that way. But being in a cult requires that you have these routines, and that even in the face of calamity, even after suffering some kind of disaster, you have to go through this process of doing personal study and reminding yourself what your beliefs are.
A brother from the Disaster Relief Committee visited us.
Yay! The Disaster Committee to the rescue!
He really listened to how we felt and gave us comfort from the Bible.
In other words, he did pretty much diddly squat. I'm sorry, but if you're a religious organization that poses as a charity, you cannot expect people to be impressed by simply offering spiritual support when calamity strikes, What matters is providing physical relief and sustenance. But this guy is just here to listen to how down they are and read them a few scriptures.
We thought about Moses' example. By faith, Moses looked intently toward the payment of the reward.
Yes, Moses, he got the full payment of the reward. As we learned in last month's rebuttal video, Moses was among the adult Israelites who crossed the Red Sea but died in the wilderness, leaving only the younger generation, Caleb, Joshua, and a few Levites, to actually successfully make it into the Promised Land. Personally, I can think of better rewards.
We finally saw what we should do. The next day, we all tried to envision the future paradise. We all felt a ray of hope enter our hearts. What is there to look forward to? I've been thinking about it for a while now. When we dwell on the disaster, what we lost, and just what we see before our eyes, then we can so easily be discouraged and lose joy. But when we look toward the reward that Jehovah will give us and the future that Jehovah has in store for us, even in such hard times, we can rejoice in the hope.
Yes, apparently wish thinking and envisioning a future paradise filled with cuddly animals and fruit is the way to get through a disaster. Never mind the fact that you've lost family members, never mind the fact that your home's been destroyed, what really matters is focusing on the carrot that the governing body is dangling in front of you. Burying one's head in the sand and living in denial works perfectly well for the governing body when it comes to their abusive child abuse policies, so why shouldn't it work for Jehovah's Witnesses when they fall on hard times?
Brother Hercules Pinto relates how he traded his desire for physical strength for something far superior.
Eu nasci para ser forte.
I was born to be strong. I was raised that way. My father was a bodybuilder and a fighter.
Por isso é que ele me deu o nome.
That's why he named me Hercules. I was raised in a seaside town in Rio de Janeiro, where my father had a gym. From early on, our life was not easy. My father was very aggressive. I felt frustrated and angry about the things that I saw happening at home. The only way I found to let out these feelings was with my fists, by fighting. I had a lot of anger inside of me. I felt worthless.
So, just as an FYI, it's useful to know that all non-Jehovah's Witnesses are aggressive and angry, and their lives outside the organization are worthless.
I loved music, especially heavy metal. So I joined many different bands. The fans' admiration felt really good.
Another FYI. Loving music and being in a band is just a selfish pursuit of admiration.
When the show ended, however, I would feel empty. I kept asking myself, is this all there is to life? Is there a purpose in life?
We're learning so much from this man's experience. Now we know that life outside Jehovah's Witnesses is empty and meaningless.
One day I was speaking to a guitarist. He was studying with Jehovah's Witnesses, and a subject came up about the soul. He began to show me in the Bible what the soul really is. What he showed me really impressed me, because it was irrefutable.
Apparently, Jehovah's Witness teachings are irrefutable. I'm guessing this would include the overlapping generation teaching, the teaching that Jesus Christ selected Joseph Rutherford and his Watchtower officers in 1919 to be his faithful slave, the teaching that beards are evil, the teaching that birthdays are evil. All of these teachings are irrefutable.
But I needed to make big changes. Leaving the band was just one of them. I still had to fight against immorality, my strong personality, my aggressive nature. But Colossians 3:10 assured me that it was possible to put on a new personality.
A man encounters a religion and finds out if he wants to join, he has to embrace a new personality that the organization has decided for him. Well, that doesn't sound remotely cult-like.
One of the things we enjoy in this work is being among the brothers.
I still love music, but I discovered that I wouldn't have any purpose in life if I weren't serving Jehovah wholeheartedly.
Again, it's always good to know that if you're one of the 7 billion people on the planet who are not Jehovah's Witnesses, your life has no purpose.
In a new video series, we'll hear from former evolutionists who began to see evidence of a creator and were moved to learn more about him.
Wow, a new feature of the JW broadcasting episodes. We are now going to have a session, apparently in future episodes, where science is routinely denied and trampled on. Well, great, I think that's actually a good thing, because it will hopefully further alienate Jehovah's Witnesses as a religion, as the crackpot creationists that they really are. I think too many Jehovah's Witnesses are under the false impression that at its heart, Watchtower respects science, and Watchtower is willing to yield to the scientific consensus. I've encountered Jehovah's Witnesses who are under the impression, the false impression, that evolution isn't frowned upon by Watchtower, which it is. Watchtower clearly labels evolution as a false teaching and has published so much material trying to refute it. So in a way, I'm glad they're doing this series, because the more they spew their ignorance, the more they expose themselves as the creationist crackpots that they are.
My name is Yaroslav Dovanich. I received my degree from the biology department of the Uzhgorod State University and specialized in zoology. I love nature very much and want to protect it. The evolutionary theory, in my opinion, quite reasonably argued that there is no creator, that everything was shaped by a series of random changes and combinations. I was unable to prove this, but I believed it. And that is why I was an evolutionist. I was a staunch evolutionist.
Right off the bat, we get ignorance and misconceptions surrounding evolution. So this zoologist guy wants us to believe that if you believe in evolution, you automatically don't believe in God. Well, thankfully, there are countless people who believe in both God and evolution. And just one example is Francis Collins. You can look him up on Wikipedia. He's the leader of the Human Genome Project. He's a respected scientist, and he happens to believe in both evolution and God. So that's the first misconception. You can, if you want to, I would suggest it's difficult, but if you want to, you can believe in both evolution and God, and indeed many, many people do. The second misconception is what this guy says about random changes. So evolution apparently is a random process. Well, this straight away tells me that he doesn't understand what evolution is. Because the more you learn about evolution, the more you understand it is not remotely random. It is a cause and effect process. So with evolution, you have a proven process where a habitat or an environment will actually mould the progress of a species so that it develops certain features that are more attuned to surviving in that habitat. That's why it's called natural selection, because nature or the environment itself actually selects which life forms are best equipped to survive. And if the creature doesn't adapt, then it dies. That is not a random process. That is cause and effect. So thank you, Watchtower, for straight off the bat showing us that you don't have a clue what evolution actually is.
While working in the Carpathian Biosphere Reserve and studying how ecological systems function, I studied nature through the lens of the evolution theory. When I studied nature through this lens, I began to notice things that contradicted the theory of evolution. I found things that couldn't have been formed by natural selection.
Examples? None given.
As I started to wonder about this, whether there is a creator, I began to discover more facts contradicting the theory of evolution. Can anyone say that some computer programs appeared simply by chance? In contrast, evolutionists would like us to believe that DNA was formed by evolution. To illustrate, say you take some letter blocks, pour them onto the table, and the Encyclopedia Britannica is formed. There is an even smaller probability that DNA originated by evolution.
What Yaroslav is doing here is pulling a trick often used by creationists, and that is to blur the lines between abiogenesis and evolution. Evolution, in a biological sense, is a proven process that is happening all around us. Whereas biological evolution uses reproduction, variation, and selection to produce new organisms, chemical evolution, or abiogenesis, deals with how life first originated in chemical form. Whereas biological evolution is proven and observed, chemical evolution, or abiogenesis, is really more of a hypothesis that is being studied by scientists. Creationists like Yaroslav tend to capitalize on this uncertainty over chemical evolution and carry it over to biological evolution in an attempt to discredit evolution in general. They assert that because abiogenesis or chemical evolution is improbable, therefore evolution in general is improbable as well. Firstly, biological evolution is in no way improbable. In fact, the more you learn about it, the more you realize that far from being improbable, it's actually inevitable. Secondly, as improbable as the theories of chemical evolution may seem, even those theories are still more plausible than the alternative, which is that every living thing on this planet was created by a supreme entity that has no beginning and no end. A perfect example of creationists trying to overstate the improbability factor can be found in Yaroslav's analogy of the letter blocks. Yaroslav quite rightly observes that if you put a load of letter blocks on a table, they're not going to form the Encyclopedia Britannica by themselves. But are letter blocks and chemicals the same? When scientists observe chemicals, what they find is that rather than just sitting together side by side as letter blocks would, certain chemicals are actually capable of interacting and forming some really quite complex structures. Given the fact that chemicals have been observed doing this, and also given enormous amounts of time for various complex chemical structures to form, it's not unreasonable for scientists to assume that something like chemical evolution could produce something as complex as RNA or DNA. And once RNA or DNA exists, you then have the basis for biological evolution to begin. To help explain why scientists are so excited about the possibilities of chemical evolution or abiogenesis, I've decided to include a few minutes from a brilliant video from the Stated Clearly channel that explains a little bit more about what chemical evolution is and how it works.
Chemical evolution refers to changes in things that need not be capable of reproduction. Examples could be individual molecules or entire chemical systems. A chemical system is a group of molecules that interact with each other. Molecules, structures, and chemical systems almost always evolve or change over time, but they often evolve towards simplicity. Solid iron corrodes into rust, when it comes in contact with the water. Proteins break down when exposed to too much heat.
Ouch!
If simple chemistry is to give rise to something advanced enough to reproduce, there must be situations in which chemical systems can grow in complexity, form new structures, and gain new functions. In order for this to happen, reproduction, which is needed in biological evolution, can be replaced with a much simpler process, repetitive production. On planet Earth and all throughout the universe, powerful natural events take place in regular cycles. The heating, and then the cooling of day and night. The repetitive eruptions of volcanic geysers. The rise and then the fall of ocean tides. These events repetitively produce or give birth to new molecules and chemical systems. These products increase over time and often develop new abilities as they interact with their environment. Let's see an example of how this process works. This here is a special molecule called a fatty acid. It's a collection of carbon atoms, hydrogen atoms, and oxygen atoms all stuck together in a specific pattern. Fatty acids are one of many complex molecules that living cells use inside their bodies. They build fatty acids with atoms they get from their environment. Scientists used to think that living cells were the only things able to consistently build fatty acids, but check this out. Lab experiments have shown that if simple common gases, carbon monoxide and hydrogen, are heated up with minerals like those found in the Earth's crust, a variety of complex carbon molecules, including fatty acids, begin to grow. Living cells are not needed. This can happen naturally in underground chambers, heated by the Earth's magma. As pressure builds, these molecules can belch up into pools of water, where a simplified version of natural selection then takes over. Most particles blasted into water will either float or they will sink. Nature selects against them staying in the watery environment. Fatty acids, however, remain suspended in warm water, growing in number as the cycle repeats. When fatty acid concentrations are high enough, they bunch together, automatically self-assembling into a stable ball. This happens because water molecules are attracted to the oxygen heads of fatty acids, sort of like a magnet, but water repels their oily carbon tails. When fatty acids pass near each other, their tails are pushed together by water, eventually forming a ball. As fatty acid collections continue to increase, they join together to make large skins. If fluctuations in these skins happen to make the edges touch, water forces those edges to fuse together. The end result is a stable, hollow container, similar to the membrane or skin of a living cell. These containers have a brand new ability. They can trap other molecules inside, acting as an entirely new environment for chemical evolution to continue working within. It's important to note that these membranes do not qualify as living creatures. They can't reproduce on their own, the same way living cells do. That said, the development of these membranes, along with many other molecules and chemical systems that scientists have observed, demonstrate an extremely important principle. Chemical evolution can give rise to new characteristics and abilities. Because of this, scientists hypothesize that under the right circumstances, chemical evolution could give rise to systems that are fully capable of reproduction. If they are correct, this would bridge the gap between chemical evolution and biological evolution, demonstrating that chemistry can indeed give rise to life.
So, long story short, biological evolution is a proven observed process, whereas chemical evolution or abiogenesis is really still a hypothesis that scientists are trying to prove. But as improbable as abiogenesis may seem, it's still more plausible to suggest that life originated through the tendency of certain chemicals to form complex structures when subjected to repetitive processes than the alternative put to us by creationists, which is that life originated through an entity who himself has no origin.
When I started to seriously consider the possibility that the world might have been created, I began to meditate about the following. I knew that religion explains that the world was created by God. So I decided to examine different religious teachings, including what the Bible says, about how God created the world.
Well, that's easy. Genesis 1 tells us that God made the earth before he made light, and that plants were created before the sun, moon, and stars were made, which of course all makes perfect sense.
The Bible is very old, thousands of years old, and yet its contents are accurate and authentic to this day.
Precisely what part of the Bible is accurate and authentic? Are we talking about the part where plants are made before there is light from the sun to allow photosynthesis? Or are we talking about the fact that Abraham and Isaac rode on camels hundreds of years before camels were domesticated? Or are we talking about the fact that the earth is described as resting on pillars and having four corners?
And the Bible contains many prophecies. These are the foretelling of events. They were to occur in the distant future, sometimes many centuries in the future. History confirms that they have been fulfilled exactly as the Bible foretold. So these predictions must have been made by someone whose abilities are far greater than man's. This proves that the author of the Bible is not man, but someone who is far wiser and has abilities which man lacks.
History absolutely does not prove that the Bible is a book of prophecy and that the Bible contains predictions that were made in advance that would be fulfilled hundreds of years in the future. If history or if archaeologists and historians genuinely believe that to be so, then it would be taught in all schools and in all colleges and in all universities. Simple truth is, if you talk to any respectable Bible scholar, they will tell you that the prophecies contained in the Bible are most likely written after the fact. What is more likely, that the Bible writers inserted events after they had happened, or that they predicted them hundreds of years in advance? Any claim that the Bible is a book of prophecy is a religious claim and not a historical claim, because it's impossible to prove that the texts weren't tampered with over the hundreds of years over which the Bible was written.
My name is Raj Kalaria. I was brought up as a nominal Hindu. My parents were Hindus. I went along with them to respect them, but I didn't really understand completely what Hindu religion was about.
Somebody who was brought up in a religious background, check. Somebody who was willing to go along with things without necessarily understanding them, check.
I studied medical sciences. I have degrees in neurosciences and pathology.
It's interesting that Professor Kalaria has qualifications in medicine, but he's being put forward as an expert on evolution.
We were taught about evolution of life, and this was just part of the curriculum. At the time, there were no other options, as it were. God did not come in the picture at all, or God creating the heavens and the earth, as it were, never came into the picture.
Professor Kalaria, the fact that you went through your education and weren't given any other options other than the theory of evolution means that you had a good education. It's a little bit like complaining that your education wasn't that good because you weren't given other options other than the theory of gravity or the theory of germ disease.
The brain is an extremely complex organ, and brain is what we are, what I am, what you are. No brain, no life. It's as simple as that.
But apparently it's not as simple as that, is it? Because Professor Kalaria believes that the human brain can go on living or be replaced after it has died, so long as the individual uses it to have full obedience and full loyalty towards a group of men in New York. That apparently is what this individual who is being put forward to us as a scientist believes. A deeply unscientific way of thinking, if you ask me. But I'm afraid this isn't just a Jehovah's Witness thing, this is a religious thing in general. This craving of people to survive their own death, to cheat their own death, this refusal to accept that death is the end. All you need to do is think about the human brain and how complex it is, as Professor Calario has just indicated, and observe what happens when someone suffers brain damage. If you remove the data from the brain, you get a different person. And if you remove the brain altogether, you get no person, you get death. So how can you have someone living on in heaven, let's say, if we're talking about the 144,000, how can we have someone living on without their brain or after their brain has been destroyed?
We started looking at the nerve cells themselves in terms of their volume and the number.
Who's we? Professor Calario suggests that numerous colleagues at Newcastle University have joined him in his investigations and implies that they have reached the same conclusions he has reached, but curiously no names are mentioned.
And it's phenomenal that in that small area of the brain, there are some 1.4 billion neurons. So the number of connections that they make, the synapses they make, is phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal. And so when you think about the complexity of all that, how is it possible that that is just by random chance? It has to be guided.
Again, we get this total misrepresentation of evolution as being a random process. As I've already explained, evolution is not a random process. It is cause and effect. All you need for evolution is an organism that can reproduce, an organism that has genetic variation or the ability to have offspring that are slightly different, and selection, the ability of the environment itself to choose which organisms are best adapted for survival. There is nothing random about this, and for Raj Kalaria to suggest that it is random tells me that he doesn't know the first thing about what evolution actually is. In fact, the more you learn about evolution, the more you realise that the development of complex organs such as the brain or the eyes is actually inevitable given the right circumstances.
Then when I was introduced to the Bible, one of the most beautiful things that struck me at the time was that there was one God. Coming from a Hindu background, the millions of gods and the Trinity, which really all was mysterious and full of mythology as well, this idea of just one God, that really appealed to me.
Professor Calario tells us that he's gone from believing in millions of gods to believing in just one God. Well, at least he's significantly closer to the true figure.
The Bible also gives us a peace of mind. It gives us a purpose in life.
Somebody needs to politely remind Professor Calario that just because a set of beliefs gives somebody a purpose in life or peace of mind, that doesn't make them true. A brilliant analogy for explaining why consoling propositions are no basis for establishing truth can be provided in the following clip by Sam Harris, where he talks about the diamond the size of a refrigerator.
This is actually an example from my book. Imagine your neighbor believes that he's got a diamond buried in his backyard that's the size of a refrigerator. Can you ask him why? And he says things like, well, you don't understand. This diamond gives my life a lot of meaning. Or my family loves the gatherings we have on the lawn digging this pit every Sunday. And are we going to take that away from us? Or imagine if he said, I wouldn't want to live in a universe where there wasn't a diamond buried in my backyard that's the size of a refrigerator. It's pretty clear, it's immediately clear, that those responses would be inadequate. Deeply inadequate. Those really are the responses of a madman or an idiot. And yet, take the same kind of thinking into the religious domain, and these responses have immense prestige.
After watching Professor Kalaria's extremely dubious comments about complexity cancelling out evolution and consoling propositions trumping logic and reason, I was actually genuinely interested to see what Newcastle University would make of it all. After all, Professor Kalaria is on their payroll, and he did seem to be trying to give the impression that his conclusions were supported by his colleagues. After a lengthy email exchange with Helen Ray, who is Newcastle University's media relations manager, the only official response I could get from them was as follows. Academic freedom, which is written into Newcastle University's statutes, allows all academic staff freedom to put forward opinions that do not necessarily represent the university, which I take to mean that Newcastle University does not support the idea that evolution is a false teaching as put forward by Professor Kalaria. I did actually reply and say nobody is disputing that Professor Kalaria has academic freedom and he's allowed to believe what he wants, but is it not slightly dubious that he's giving the impression in the video that his conclusions are supported by his colleagues? And unfortunately, I got no further comment.
Did you notice that both men studied the complexity of living things from a different perspective, but found similar evidence for an intelligent designer?
These men found no evidence of an intelligent designer. If they found such evidence, all they would need to do is write up their conclusions, get them peer-reviewed, and then collect their Nobel Prize. The scientific community is, after all, anxious to reward scientists who advance our understanding by getting rid of commonly held misconceptions. If the scientific community is wrong about evolution, and these men have the proof, all they need to do is get it written up and present it, but they don't have proof. All they've managed to prove to us is their credulity and their willingness to sweep aside any credibility they may have to advance Watchtower's agenda.
We went along with several groups of children to find out why they visited Bethel and what that visit taught them about the organization and Jehovah.
It took me 3 hours and 48 minutes.
It took us 2.5 to 3 hours to get here.
I would rather go to Bethel than sit down and watch TV on my sofa.
I got to go to Bethel just like Caleb and Sophia.
Is this the same Caleb and Sophia who were threatened with death if they didn't pay attention at the meetings?
When I saw the Sophia and Caleb Bethel video, I thought I wanted to see it at my Bethel.
I really, really wanted to go after that because we haven't been here for a long time. It's a great experience and it's nice to see what they're doing here.
What they're doing here is exporting cult propaganda on an industrial scale while claiming tax exemption and charitable status.
If you go to other places, they are dirty. But here it isn't, because this is Jehovah's house.
Yes, of course. This can't be a cult factory, because why would a cult factory be spotlessly clean?
To other kids who haven't toured Bethel yet, they should try to come and visit, because they won't only enjoy the experience, they'll also learn many things about Jehovah's organization.
I would tell kids that didn't want to come to Bethel that they're missing out on something that is so great and loving from Jehovah. It showed me that Jehovah is a loving and kind God.
What amazes me about this clip is the blatant peer pressure. I was constantly being told when growing up as a Jehovah's Witness, both in the Young People Ask book and in magazine articles and at meetings, that I was to resist pressure from people who were my age to conform to what they wanted me to do. And what we've just seen in this clip is that exact practice being demonstrated. You know, young people pressuring or being made to pressure other young people to do something that they want to do. It's also worth pointing out the irony of young people promoting an organisation that routinely lets them down and puts them in harm's way through its negligent child abuse policies. Watchtower has no qualms about exploiting these, you know, beautiful children, even though at the same time it is quite happily putting them in situations where they could very easily be abused and have that abuse covered up.
Jehovah's people worldwide appreciate spiritual things. That's why we're eager to attend the 2016 convention with the theme, Remain Loyal to Jehovah.
I don't think I've yet been in a situation where the theme of a convention has been released and I've been wondering in the back of my mind whether it's a practical joke. It's just amazing that Watchtower can call a convention Remain Loyal to Jehovah and be oblivious to the fact that that sounds extremely cult-like to anyone who's an outsider. And bear in mind that usually when it comes to conventions, Watchtower likes to get the media involved and likes to invite journalists along who can write about how wonderful the conventions are. Well, this year, journalists have got to come along and try and figure out why they are being asked to write nice things about a convention that, rather than just giving a generic Christian theme, is specifically telling those in attendance that they need to remain loyal to Jehovah, and by Jehovah it obviously means to the organisation. In a way, it's reassuring that the organisation is so desperate to stem the flow of people leaving that it has to come up with such a blatantly controlling title for one of its conventions. And judging by some of the talks on the programme, there's going to be a heck of a lot of apostate bashing and paranoia. So it'll be interesting to see whether the convention lives up to its paranoid billing.
The governing body wants you to see the exciting previews of the two video dramas that we'll enjoy at the convention. The first is a modern-day depiction that draws from the life experiences of Job.
So, Dad, how many stars are there?
Straight away, if we're dealing with a film where a guy starts off with a beautiful family, I think it's safe to say that if it's being based on the story of Job, it's safe to say that he's going to lose that beautiful family, or at least he should if it's going to be based on Job, because as we discussed, I think, in the last JW Broadcasting rebuttal, Job did lose his entire family, and this was all some kind of, all part of some game between God and Satan. Satan insisted he could turn Job against Jehovah, and Jehovah said, okay, give it a go. And Job ended up losing his children. So that's apparently what needs to happen. This film needs to have lots of death, lots of crying, lots of suffering. But something tells me that at the end of it all, he is going to reaffirm his loyalty and obedience to the organisation. It really wouldn't surprise me as well if there's going to be something in it about the blood issue, because you see in the trailer, you know, the guy being consulted by a doctor, and you also get the hint that the child might be ill as well. So probably there's going to be some kind of stand taken on blood. Who knows? I can only imagine, though, that it will be a very depressing experience to watch it.
Personally, I think it's best to treat this as aggressively as possible. My recommendation is surgery.
Everything happens for a reason.
Prayer? There's nobody listening.
What's your future? You don't have any money. You're drowning in debt. You don't even have a job.
Everything I've done for my family's spirituality. Spirituality,
okay.
Bill, that's
okay.
Why you don't...
Okay!
Where's the team? Where's the one flesh?
I can't provide for my family at all. I wake up sick every morning, useless, wanting to die.
What a cheerful family film.
And he will wipe out every tear from their eyes. and death will be no more. Neither will mourning nor outcry nor pain me anymore. The former things have passed away.
What were you talking about?
Hope.
We've been brought back full circle from what we were hearing before in the dramatisation about the Japanese family who survived a typhoon. Watchtower's message is to be in denial, to bury your head in the sand, and to just have hope. And the hope is a future promise that can never be delivered on. And Watchtower never needs to be held accountable for it, because it can always say Armageddon is just around the corner, just a little while longer. Honestly, it'll be with us any moment now. And witnesses can live their entire lives in expectation of that. And if they die before it happens, well, the next generation just carries on. And, you know, soldiers on, carries on the baton to the next generation. And Watchtower can be completely off the hook. And the amazing thing is, when you read the old publications, we're going back, you know, into the 40s, 30s, 20s, the urgency was there as well. And they genuinely expected Armageddon to come any moment. And the people who wrote those books are now dead. Many of the people who read those books are now dead. But, you know, the current generation of Jehovah's Witnesses just refuses to learn the lesson and just allows themselves to be led along on this, you know, merry-go-round of disappointment where successive generations are just being duped. So yes, hope can get you through an awful lot of bad things, but it isn't necessarily healthy to hang everything on hope, especially when it comes to baseless doomsday predictions.
The second drama, prepared for the convention, follows the biblical account of King Hezekiah and how he courageously put his trust in Jehovah.
Assyrians at the gate!
Did you escape?
I disguised myself as one of the Assyrian soldiers. They finally broke through the wall. They singled out the leading men of the city, and they skinned them alive.
The Assyrians will come for us. It's wise to take practical measures.
If we paid the tribute, we wouldn't need to surrender, and we wouldn't need to fight.
What have you done? Our children will die! You kill her!
Oh goody, a cinematic feast of fake beards and terrible acting. It's nice to know that even though Watchtower is so short of cash that it needs to lay off Bethelites and Special Pioneers, close branches and reduce printing, at least it still has some money left to make cheap rip-offs of films like 300 and Gladiator.
Trust in Jehovah, Hezekiah. He never disappoints those who are loyal to him.
I obviously haven't seen the film yet, so I have no way of knowing, but I really hope that the old man who's telling King Hezekiah to have trust in Jehovah and everything's going to work out, I really hope that that character is, in fact, Isaiah the prophet. Because if it's Isaiah, that means that there is a delicious irony in this JW broadcasting episode, because Hezekiah's son was none other than King Manasseh. Yes, the same King Manasseh that sacrificed his children and chopped up Isaiah. What a delicious irony it would be if Hezekiah is here receiving advice from a prophet of Jehovah who would later be butchered by Hezekiah's son, who in turn would later be forgiven by the same God that Isaiah is representing. If that's not a reason for Isaiah to feel disappointed by Jehovah, I really don't know what is.
The faithful and discreet slave lovingly keeps providing what we need to keep pace with Jehovah's advancing organization. And so this month's music video warmly encourages us to keep the pace.
The scene of this world is changing. I can't live in the past. Please help me to keep running, because we're moving fast.
As something of a Watchtower geek and a collector of Watchtower literature, I couldn't help but notice the Rutherford Rainbow there, which I obviously have a copy of myself for those of you who are eagle-eyed enough to spot it on my bookshelves. But yeah, I found this song interesting because it's actually quite a nice catchy tune. It's saying keep the pace, but the message I feel is quite clear at the beginning. It's showing old Watchtower publications and it's saying, well, these are very nice, but what we really need to do is keep the pace and move along with Jehovah's organization by focusing on up-to-date material. And isn't that convenient when you're an organization that has been spewing changing doctrines and false predictions for over 130 years, how convenient it is if you have followers who can conveniently forget about all of those false predictions and about all of those doctrinal flip-flops and focus instead on what you're writing now, because it gives you just a blank check to just continue duping people for decades to follow. Watchtower wants Jehovah's Witnesses to have a very selective memory when it comes to the organization's history and old publications.
You may have noticed that the original soundtracks of our music videos have been added to the audio category of JW Broadcasting.
No, I didn't notice that.
You can also download them to the JW Library app. Once the files have been downloaded to your device, you'll have two additional options for playing your songs. You can press the Play All button or play tracks randomly by pressing the Shuffle button. Downloading the files to the JW Library app lets you play them again and again at no additional download or streaming costs to the organization.
Yes, I didn't know this, but apparently just by downloading JW Broadcasting episodes or by downloading music from Watchtower, we are actually costing them money. This isn't something I'd thought of before, but the guys on Reddit, I noticed they had a thread about this particular comment by William Malenfant, and someone did some digging, and it's difficult to know exactly what the figures would be, but he figured out that it would be something like around the region of 10 cents to download a JW Broadcasting episode. It depends on what arrangement Watchtower has with their hosting provider, but I just find it fascinating that just by downloading Watchtower content, we are costing the organization some money. But this got me to thinking, surely there are some more ingenious ways that Watchtower could raise some cash if they are indeed in the perilous situation that they are apparently in. And one way, I just think William Malenfant has got a fantastic voice. I think out of all the governing body helpers, you listen to William Malenfant and that kind of dramatic voice that has so much gravity to it, and you think, why is he not a governing body member? You compare his voice with that of, say, Tony Morris or Stephen Lett, and William Malenfant's voice just seems to have so much more kind of gravity and oomph to it. And I think what Watchtower should do is they should sell William Malenfant's voice as a sat-nav voice. And here's what I think it would sound like. In 300 meters, experience the joy of arriving at your destination. Do not look back. Instead, pay careful heed to these instructions and maintain your steadfast course. Once you have made a left turn, proceed onwards with boldness and zeal. You are on the path to destruction. Make a U-turn at the next junction and live. I don't know about you, but every journey would be a joy if my sat-nav sounded like that. Watchtower, the world needs a William Malenfant sat-nav voice. Make it happen. I'm afraid that's all I've got time for this month's rebuttal, but I hope you found it interesting, and as always, thank you for watching.